receiver to platform integration, receiver functional testing, advanced technology lab research, system security tasks, and he and his team are leading the integration of modernized GPS user equipment, or as we like to call it, MGUE. And he's doing this for various platforms across the U.S. military services. In addition to that, the exciting part about today is he's also a C-17 aircraft commander as a traditional reservist in the 729th Airless Squadron based out of March Air Force Base in California. He has logged over 1,800 flight hours in the C-17 Globemaster III, and 400 plus of those hours have been in combat. In addition, we have Commander Kyle Dreamweaver. He is the Navy Liaison for Space and Naval Warfare Systems Command, SPAWAR, PMWA-170, from San Diego, and the Navy Deputy Program Manager for Navigation Integration at the Space and Missile Systems Center's GPS Director. Not quite San Diego, but we're trying to get there for one of these, so maybe Sunday. He works with the Navy organization around the U.S. to ensure that Navy interests are represented in the modernization of the GPS enterprise. Dreamweaver has over 2,100 hours in the F-18 and 394 carrier landings. That's a moving platform. 155 of them during the hours of darkness. So he graduated from the United States Naval Academy with a degree in computer science, so he's a techie too. So, gentlemen, the tutorial is yours, and just a round of applause.
All right, morning everyone. Like Mike said, thanks for having us. I'm Commander Kyle Weaver, this is Cameron Adams, and we're the Dream Team. We're going to talk about some of the historical methods of where we got to navigation today, and some of the things that led up to it, and how we can kind of look to the future. In the past, when man first started traveling, there was a lot of challenges. Land travel had its disadvantages. There were certainly lots of pitfalls and challenges, and whether it's through people or mountains or rivers or even oceans, there was a lot of challenges with land travel, and it was slow. Sea travel certainly had its disadvantages too. So we're going to talk about some of the things that took place. How we developed some of the navigation tools that we have today, and kind of where they came from and some of their lineage. So stars, wind, water, all play a pretty important part in developing the navigation that we know today. However, as a lot of people will see, time plays kind of an essential role in continuing threads through this story. And then we'll look a little bit at nature. The stars, early astronomers used the stars to describe things. The constellations were a result of early people looking up to the skies and saying, the gods have a story for us, and these are our stories that they want us to know. But they also had a practical purpose as well. The movement of the stars and the location of the stars throughout the year were important indicators for agricultural events, for religious events, for social events. In early times. But they also allowed travelers to navigate. We'll see in a little bit the North Star is kind of a key point in navigation, especially in the northern hemisphere. People look to that as one of the essential part of navigation, especially in old times when there wasn't a whole lot of tools to work with. As far back as 100 BC, this mechanism here is called the Anticlera mechanism. You probably heard about a little bit about it. It was found in a shipwreck from about 100 BC. It was discovered in about 1900. It was passed along. They thought it was a simple astrolabe where you just get some star positions. But in the 70s, they started going through it, looking, examining it with X-rays. We realized it was actually a very complicated mechanism. And this mechanism, predated a lot of the knowledge that was written down about where the stars are, what the celestial body movements were, and how it works. It was actually a very, very precise instrument to give celestial prediction of celestial events, even decades in advance. We think that that early navigators had this as part of their toolkit to figure out where they were, what they were doing, and what to expect during their travels. True North, like we mentioned, Polaris is almost over the North Pole, and the Earth basically rotates beneath it. The early navigators could use this for navigation. You find the Big Dipper, about five times the distance between those two stars is a North Star. It's also a pretty easy way to find latitude in the Northern Hemisphere. It's almost directly over the North Pole. If you're not freezing your butt off in the North Pole and you're further south a little bit, you can figure out how far up it is using your hand. Outstretched hand with a closed fist is about 5 degrees. If you open it up, that's about 10 degrees. And you can figure out what your latitude is based on that simple measurement. Wind also plays an important role in the development of navigation. We'll see in this graphic, the trade winds are a predictable source of locomotion as well as navigation for early travelers. These vertical cells called Hadley cells, combined with the motion of the Earth, make these predictable winds in the different bands throughout the globe. The northeast trade winds were very extensively used in travels from Europe, and kind of explain why a lot of the early discoveries were down in the Caribbean, because those trade winds took us into that area. We'll see on the next couple slides, currents had a big part to do with that. Up in the north, the westerlies, combined with the interaction, weather interactions with the polar front, gives us things like the jet stream, which we'll see in a second. Down around the equator, you get this intertropical convergence zone, and that's where the vertical pump component there with the Hadley cells creates this area called the doldrums, and that's kind of the bane for any sailor. So a lot of people didn't travel too much further south than the equator initially because of those doldrums that sailors couldn't get through. Here's an example of what the jet stream looks like. It's a band of higher velocity wind up in the mid-thousands, 20, 30, 40,000 feet, that provide us with a great tool today to get from west to east with a little bit of efficiency. Okay, we talked about currents. Throughout the oceans, there's also a lot of currents that play into our navigation story. As we just mentioned, coming from Europe into the discoveries into the New World, there was a current that comes off of Europe and takes us basically down into the Caribbean. Additionally, on their return trips, the Gulf Stream that runs along the east coast of the U.S. Provided 3 or 4 knots at times of assistance in the direction they wanted to go. Combine that with the trade winds that we just talked about, and you have a perfect solution for a round trip to and from Europe. Just like the winds, we quickly realized that there were some vertical components to these currents around the world, and they helped to explain some of the effects and the observed animal life, plant life that the oceans show. These currents have the ocean elevator transports this water all around the world. And gives those surface currents the ability to provide food, provide nourishment to all of those biodiverse areas throughout the world. Early navigators also used the tides as part of their toolkit. By figuring out what the tides, how the tides acted, where the locations of the highest currents were and the lowest currents were. Local navigators get to and from places with the minimum of effort. If they were on the wrong side of the tide, then they're fighting the water to get where they needed to go. They also played a part in the further development of some of our navigational knowledge in that it predicted and showed some of the interaction of the celestial bodies. Early on, we thought that that everything revolved around the Earth. Sure, the moon does, but the Earth doesn't. But there's this interaction between the moon and the sun to provide the different types of tides, the new tides, the spring tides, and early navigators knew these differences, were able to predict these, And they also played into that that knowledge development to provide an accurate model of how the solar system works. All right, moving on. Sun, wax, sand, water, what does all that have in common? Surfing? Yeah? Okay, well, it also has to do with time. All right? Early people used sundials as part of their, in order to tell time. But they realized that the time didn't stay the same throughout the year. And this is due to a couple things. It's due to the Earth's rotation, the tilt, as well as the eccentricity of the orbit. And this equation of time, the black line there, is a combination of those two effects that they observed. A sundial is typically suspect to a few vulnerabilities. You know, certainly need the sun to be able to read that. Obviously at night it's not going to help you a whole lot either. So we need a few other ways to keep track of time. Hourglasses were simple. They were effective. They were good ways to measure an interval of time. Candles. That's the wax part on the previous slide. Candles were often used to keep time as well. Medieval scientists used a candle to measure an amount of time throughout the night. For all the preppers in the room, that box of Crayola crayons, if you light one of those, that'll last about an hour. So that 128 colors that you can't figure out, that this blue from that blue, it's an hour worth of light if you need to use it and you decide to go to grab. All right. Sand, however, wasn't real precise. So, that's on the left there, that's called a water clock or a clepsydra. And that was a more precise way to measure an interval of time. So they could, a few different implementations of the water clock, but you had a pretty good method to measure a certain amount of time or measure an interval if you needed to do that. Okay. Certainly, these timing pieces were pretty crude with respect to today's standard, but you bring a little sand and water together, what do you got? You got high fives all around. All right. There we go. Okay. So, who's a timekeeper? If we got any naval observatory people in here? Hopefully you've seen a few. All right. So, these guys have been at it for a long time. These are the nation's timekeeper. On the upper left hand corner, that's one of our rubidium clocks. By far the most precise clocks in the world. However, even up into the 1990s, the transit telescope here, and we'll talk about how that works a little bit later, was used to just to verify that the time we were keeping was accurate. Initially, the Naval Observatories was tasked with keeping the chronometers that the ships use throughout the Navy synced up and in calibration, so that our navigation solutions were as tight as they could possibly be. So they're still at it, and that's the Naval Observatory. Okay, let's move on to figuring out where we are and what we're doing. Throughout history, we've seen lots of different stories. Some of these epic stories from around the turn of the millennium, Homer's Odyssey or Jason and the Argonauts tell these fantastic journeys about going to these crazy places. But these were also used by navigators and part of the navigation. Knowledge base as to what islands were out there, what they looked like, what they contained, so the travelers could use them. Certainly, some of the stories of what happened on those islands might have gotten exaggerated just a little bit, but it's still an important part of the development of navigation. Here's another example. This is an Irish romance down here, The Adventures of Maldon or Merlin. Describe some of the islands up in the North Atlantic, and a lot of these could potentially have been described long before the official discovery of these islands took place in history. All right, map makers are kind of a rough lot, though. This is a 1500 representation of Ptolemy's geography and some of the things that he described in his geography. Epic. He did a lot of work in developing spherical geometry and the application to motion, to time, and to developing a way to navigate using the sun and the moon. Okay, this is a representation of what they think his thought process was, in the early 100s or 200s when he came up with this stuff. However, every map tells a story. Every mapmaker is subject to a little influence from their surroundings. The map on the left here is from the Turkish Admiral Piri Reis in the 1500s, and for the conspiracy theorists out there, this map is significant because it supposedly shows a very detailed outline of the Antarctic coast, even though that Antarctic coast is beneath the mile of ice. So, where did this come from? Supposedly the aliens did some ancient surveys and passed this information on. Who knows? However, this type of information, a lot of early maps were a conglomeration of a whole bunch of different sources. Travelers passed this on from one to the other. Sometimes they kept it close hold because it was a source of war might or commercial might. But at other times they passed along and kind of came up with increasingly accurate in some cases, sometimes a little inaccurate, as we can see here on the right. This is from a Korean mapmaker. The nationalities of and their interactions with the countries around them have a lot to do with the way the maps look. Obviously, Korea's got a pretty big landmass there. China and India are mushed all together. You can see going around the Indian Peninsula into the Persian Gulf. Africa is really easily discernible there. You can tell by the big lake in the middle. Sometimes there's maybe not as much accuracy you want, but this map is telling a story. This map is telling a story from the Korean map maker standpoint. Okay, there's a lot of subjectivity even today in the maps that we see. Here's another example. This is a Spanish map maker showing obviously the extreme power that Spain is exerting in the New World and all the conquests and conquered territories that they've got. Across the Atlantic. Okay, so it's not just national pride. It's not just telling the national story. Also, data. You can put data onto a map, and it tells a different story depending on what story you're, what cause you have. Here's a map showing the commuting habits from the affluent neighborhood of Grosse Pointe to downtown Detroit, and it shows where all the commuters have hit black kids. During this time period. So this mapmaker obviously has a story that he wants to tell, something that he wants to get to the reader that sees his map. Okay, all historical examples, things that have happened in the past. Are we immune to that today? We have these high tech things. We have satellites, stuff like that. No, absolutely not. Anybody know what this is?
Coffee stain.
I like a coffee stain. Okay, so this is an image of China's new passport. Okay, so there's the outline of China there in the middle, and then down here at the bottom is a new addition to their map. That's a 9-dash line. Okay, in 1947 or something, they drew this 9-dash line, basically encompassing the whole South China Sea, claiming economic exclusion zone rights to everything that took place in the South China Sea. Obviously, the Philippines and Vietnam and Indonesia and all the countries around there weren't too cool with that. So, this is just this year, the new passport has this 9-dash line. Again, stirring up some of the things that that South China Sea hotspot has to deal with. Okay. All right. Cameron insisted that we talk about the birds and the bees. Everybody need a little lesson on that? Okay, we'll skip. Nina, you need some. Okay, we'll skip some of the details, but there is a little known fact about homing pigeons. You can never lose a homing pigeon, right? You let it go, and if it doesn't come back, all you've really lost is a pigeon. So a lot of a lot of research goes into what navigation in nature looks like. How do different animals know where they're going? How to get where they're going, and then how to get back. Homing pigeons, some of the you know, the prevailing research thinks that, you know, maybe it's smell, maybe it's sound, maybe it's some sort of magnetic compass that they have. They can determine the landscape based on you know, where they are and where they need to go. It's amazing, and it's things that, you know, that we use as part of our development of navigation, and certainly may play a part of some of our future navigation capabilities. As far as the bees, a key line is a term that's associated with the ways bees forage for food. A forager bee will be out going in seemingly random directions until he finds a source of food. Once he finds a source of food, he'll go directly back to the nest. Do his little waggle dance. One of my, you want to do a demo of that?
If time permits,
we'll do the waggle dance at the end. The waggle dance, all the other bees see that, they make a beeline directly to that that food source and come back, okay? How do they do it? They think, you know, a lot of it has to do with the sun. They have some innate ability to know where the sun is, what the motions of the sun throughout the year, depending on their location. You know, so there's a lot of mystery, but, you know, some good thoughts about it. Monarch butterflies, these guys got the long-term solution for navigation. They take off from Southern California or Mexico. First generation flies until they get tired. You know, they land, they breathe, they die. The next generation wakes up, they fly north, get tired, land, breathe, die. Next generation flies one more time up to, you know, northern U.S., southern Canada, lands, breathes, dies. That fourth generation wakes up, says, what are we doing up here? It's getting late, it's getting cold, we're going south. They fly all the way south, start the cycle again. How's that happen? Multi-generational, they end up in the same places. They end up going back to those same hibernation locations. Things that we can learn about. All right? A lot of you associated with the military, we use TLAs. Three-letter acronyms for things. So we'll talk about PNT now. Position, navigation, timing. Along the side here, you'll see a list, and we'll talk about them here in the position section of all the data that are out there. And these are, you know, there's a whole bunch of them. We'll talk about why there's a whole bunch of them as we get going on. First of all, audience participation. Who thinks that the Earth is flat? No one? Okay. Well, these guys think you're wrong. This is a flat Earth society symbol. So, I'll assume everybody else thinks the Earth is round, or somewhere thereabouts. Okay, is it round, spherical, or is it round, kind of pear-shaped? Pear-shaped? Oblong? Yeah, it's not pretty. Okay, it's a really, really rough shape. This is a magnetic representation of the Earth that is pretty accurately describes what that geoid, what the actual shape of the Earth looks like. You know, it's not an easy solution. Okay, somehow we gotta solve for that though. So what do? We have an ellipsoid. That's our mathematical estimation of what the Earth looks like. The actual shape of the Earth is that red line, the geoid. So when we were, you know, calling for coordinates and you know, picking a point on the Earth, we got to come up with some way to decide between those and come up with a good way to correctly identify the point that we're really talking about. In GPS terms, this is height above the ellipsoid, okay, H80, and that's that green letter H there. The blue letter H, what do we commonly refer to that as? MSL, mean sea level. Okay, that's, you know, the height above the geoid. That is commonly referred to as mean sea level. Okay. So we got the geoid. That's the actual shape. We saw that whole list of damage. Why do we have so many? Because we really like to be exact as we can in our local area, right? So all these local dams, you know, especially the ones like Clark 66 and North American Datum 27, use a local reference point. Okay, a global datum like WGS 84 or GRS 80, they use a Earth center point. Okay, so the difference is for these local datums, you get a really nice fit in the local area that you're interested in. Yeah, but if you're using this green data and want to get a point over here, then you got some issues, okay? You know, the distance is way off and you're not accurate. So the global data, try to get that best fit globally, okay? okay? But you can see that, you know, that for this point right here, which the local datum is perfect for, it's a little rough on the global datum, so we have corrections, okay? And that's you know, the mathematics part of how the global datums work and, you know, where they fit in, okay? So everybody thinks that that the Earth is round, that or some, you know, some variation of round. Now we got to get back to the flat Earth. How do we put that onto a 2D representation? Okay, this is projections. So the challenge of projections is there's going to be some distortion. Taking that that three-dimensional shape and laying it out flat, how do you best represent what you need to show? And again, it has to do with there's a little bit of politics and subjectivity involved, but there's also some practical reasons to do what you want to do. The Mercator projection is probably our most commonly used one. It uses any grids that are angularly representative for navigation, so then you can take an angle off of the Mercator projection and know what direction you need to go as far as a bearing. Okay. However, as you can see, the distortion on a Mercator projection, especially up near the poles, has a significant effect on the way things look. Okay, so almost a 1-to-1 ratio of Greenland to Africa for the Mercator projection. And this section here is an equal area projection, so all wide. Or the next slide, we'll see some a combo. This is a Peters equal area projection. The other one is a combo. It's called a Robinson projection. And the one up at the top is a Mercator projection with the gigantic Antarctica. But you can see that, you know, that the shapes, you know, have to do with the field. Okay, so the Mercator projection is used for a long time, even since the 1500s. And part of that reason is not that practical reason, but it's because it shows the, you know, the more powerful nations on the Earth, you know, that northern hemisphere, all through here, as very large nations. Okay, so there's a mental piece to that that map as well. Okay, coordinate systems. What's this map of? What's that showing there? Anybody have an idea? MGRS, military grid reference system. Okay, so we've taken the Mercator projection, we've broken it down into grid, and we put some labels on the grid. Okay, the first two numbers and a letter is going to be our grid zone. Okay, we'll take a look at North America and do some mapping with MGRS. Zooming into to Maryland area, we've got our grid zone there, which is 18 Sierra, and then these letters in here are 100 kilometer square grids. Okay, so 100 kilometers on each side. Okay, as we start zooming in, keep an eye down on this this lower corner, and I'll read them as we get to them. Here's a 10 kilometer grid. So we've got one digit of accuracy in our MGRS. So we get the grid zone, the 100 kilometer grid designation, and then a set number of digits afterwards, 1 to 2 to 10 digits is common, depending on how much precision you need for the coordinates that you're passing. Okay, and we'll remember this is grid. We'll talk about the difference between grid and coordinates a little bit later, but I may use coordinates interchangeably. Okay, start zooming in. Each of these grids is going to go down by a factor of 10. So we're looking at that 100 kilometer grid, that's the two letters. The 10 kilometer grids, one letter in the east, one letter in the north, or one number in the east, one letter, one number in the north. We're down to a 1 kilometer grid, that's going to have two numbers in the easterly, and then two numbers in the northerly. Okay? And as we keep moving in, we start adding, you know, by pairs, numbers to this MGRS grid. So this is the Robert Crown Sailing Center at the Naval Academy, and this is 8-digit precision, or tough to see on this screen, I guess, you know, a 10-meter grid for this area. We can go one more. I didn't have any imagery of that, but if we do 10 digits of precision, that takes us down to 1 meter of a grid coordinates. Okay? So 18 Sierra, Uniform Juliet, 7187, or 7198-1585 is your coordinates there for that lower left corner of the grid. Okay? So we use those to call in precise coordinates. Again, up to 10 digits, we get down to a meter of precision. And we can use those in a lot of different means. However, we're still talking about a grid, okay, not actual coordinates. In some situations, we're going to use an actual grid reference system. This is called the little area reference system. And it is a similar construct of letters and numbers. So in this one, we break it down with three letters, three numbers, two letters, and then a keypad of 4 or a keypad of 9. Okay, so each of the numbers and letters are going to be a 30x30 minute grid. When you break down into quadrants, you can get a 15x15 grid, and then if you go into a 9-digit keypad, then you get a 5x5 minute grid. Okay, this is commonly used in kill box operations or Type 3 close air support. Where you may not have a specific target to work with, you need to get into an area, you need to do some search. Airborne or air interdiction has to do with an open area where you're looking for something. Okay, so you can get down to a 5 mile square area with that 5x5 grid, and that can, you know, then you can get talk on or do your search routines as required from there. Okay, so now we're talking about actual Cartesian coordinates. You know, V in lambda or lat in long are the two the most common method. Depending on who you're talking to and what the system they're using is, you can go with a degrees and decimal with something like that, a degrees minutes and decimal like that, or degrees minutes seconds. All of these are all of the coordinates on here. The same place at various levels of detail and various methods for employment. Okay, so you can see that there's, you know, a high chance of confusion unless you're very clear about what type of coordinates you're using and you know, how you're going to use them. Okay, moving on. Navigation. You know, there's lots of tools we use for navigation, whether it's a compass and a map, whether it's a GPS and a digital map system, whether it's a sextant and a chronometer and a whole stack of books. These are all methods that tools that we use for navigation. But what we're really looking for is to answer three questions. Where are we going? How do we get there? And we're going the right way. Okay. So, dead reckoning is the most basic form of providing this navigation information. And this is just an estimate, okay? You need to know where you're starting, what direction you're heading, and how fast. And you time that, and you come up with an estimated position, okay? Almost every system does this kind of in the background. They say, you know, we're right here, we've made these certain motions, we should be right here, right now. And then at some point that gets updated with the actual position, okay? But dead reckoning is kind of the basis for the navigation that we see today. We'll skip the video on that. Plotting positions. You know, this is always a challenge. Whether you're using a GPS type tool or whether you're using visual lookouts and bringing in bearings, it's very dependent on the precision of the tool that you have. Okay, I think the Chinese and some of the Vikings had some crude compasses to their avail, but it wasn't until about the 14th or 1500s where the Italians developed a very reliable floating compass, like similar to what we use today. It became this allowed the Italians to kind of become the powerhouse of navigation that they are today. Are they? Okay. So, let's look at timing a little bit. These early chronometers in the 1700s, the King of England said, "Hey, we got to figure this out. We know that if we know, what time it is, we can get a good, accurate celestial fix. We need accurate timekeepers for our ships." So he put out a, you know, a 20,000-pound reward to in the 1700s, which is a ton of money. Put out a reward for anybody who can come up with a with an accurate timepiece over a longer period of time under maritime conditions. So this guy, Harrison, came up with this timepieces within 15 seconds over about a half-year trip to the Barbados and back to England, and said, you know, show me the money. He didn't get the money right away. You know, the King of England gave him a little bit, didn't pay fully until later, but it provided you know, that start to how to keep time under varying conditions, okay? It allowed a lot of progress to take place in the navigation space, especially with respect to celestial navigation. Okay, the celestial piece, especially at sea, was important because it was predictable, it was calculable, and like we saw the. With the North Star, you know, there were some key things you could do even without a sextant or a sextant. You could find that North Star. You could easily figure out what direction you're in. It goes with the information you use on your eyes. You didn't need tools. You didn't need time, but you were able to get that initial kickstart. And then this guy comes around. This guy, he makes it easy. Okay. He produces his epitome of navigation, the Bowditch's practical navigator, which made it easy to, relatively easy, to calculate your position using the stars. Okay, time was still a piece of it, but it didn't have to be the ultra precise time that early navigators were hoping for, because of the information that he put into here. Made even public math a little bit easier for the crazy sailors. Okay, how do we use time today? Lots of different things. Cell towers use it so that you can go from cell tower to cell tower. Businesses use it for keeping track of transactions and timestamps on events. FAA uses it to sync up their Doppler radar so that you can get a decent picture of the weather on the Weather Channel. power companies use it. Here's the image of the blackouts in 2003 in the Northeast. This was attributed to the time phase of the currents getting out of whack and breaking down that whole section of the grid. Okay. Science, here's the Fermi National Lab, particle accelerator. Even Hollywood's getting involved in the GPS time stuff. They need a precise time so that all of these films and they can sync them up with their graphics, sync them up with external events, so that what you see on the screen looks good. Okay. Okay. So how do we get to where we are? Most of you are familiar with the history of space navigation. Started with Sputnik, Transit, GPS 3 is coming online here in the next couple of years. Transit was an old Navy system. We kind of got this thing started. Again, we're kind of the leaders, I guess, in navigation, at least the need for it. It gave us reasonable accuracy, but it took a long time to get the fix. Okay, GPS gives us a lot quicker fixes, a lot better accuracy, and again, brings in that time piece. That makes it important. Military uses GPS, through various means to get some specific information from that GPS signal that isn't generally put out. However, it comes with a couple benefits. We've been talking about space navigation so far. Can we do this stuff on the Earth? Absolutely. Earth navigation is still available, and it might be one of the things we're looking at in the future with new systems. Okay, Omega was a worldwide system, not super exact, but it was a worldwide system. Loran and DECA were closer in systems out to about 1,500 kilometers somewhere in there. There's beacons, there's VORDME or TACANs that provide even closer load situations. Most of these have to do with a couple transmitters. and then doing the triangulation between the difference in the received signal, DOR, or POR, DME, and TACANS, use a single transmitter station to do that same thing. All right, skip the NS section. And then we got some automated systems. The days of having the sextant, looking at a book of charts or a book of tables is gone. There's these systems use a celestial automated tracker. Again, depending on the technology used, it could be just a few stars that they're looking for. It could be a wide range of stars. We look to future systems to be able to have a bigger catalog of those stars for navigation. Okay, here's a few other possible ways that, or actual ways that we use it. Here's the TLAM using the scene matching mode. There's also a terrain contour matching mode. Using radar overlays on charts helps to give a couple different sources to both position from the GPS, position on a map that we're looking at, and then overlaying that radar image on the chart gives you a second way to back up the information that you're getting. Okay. So, I'm going to turn over to Cameron. He's going to talk about some of the C-17 capabilities that that exist and how we use the navigation C-17.
Hey, thanks, Dream. Appreciate it. This is the lecture.
Yeah,
thanks, Dream. That was a good segue into modern navigation techniques, and we'll talk a little bit about that now. I'm going to give you a little tutorial, if you will, on both navigation on the C-17, both Block 16 and Block 17, as well as the actual employment or operation of the system. The C-17, as many of you know, is our nation's premier and newest strategic and tactical airlifter. And I've been very blessed to have about 10 years of flying experience. And what you're going to see is a brief summary of some of the training that I provide to our crew members. So without further ado, let's get started. Again, I broke it up into a navigation description as well as an operational employment. The C-17, Block 16, and Block 17 have either two or four GPS receivers. The Block 16 aircraft has two PPS-based GPS receivers embedded in what we call the IRUs, or inertial reference units, more commonly known as EGIs, embedded GPS INS systems. The GPS receivers are embedded into two of the four IRUs, IRUs number 1 and number 4, but with this Block 17, C-17, there was a modification that brought in two civil GPS receivers to meet the civil airspace certifications. And so what we have is two civil GPS receivers and the precision landing system receivers or pleasers. And those are operated via a rotary switch in the cockpit. Interestingly, the IRU-based GPS system utilizes a 7-element controlled reception pattern antenna, its own antenna system, which is a separate standalone system to the antenna that's used for the civil GPS system built into the pleasers. So how does the C-17 calculate its present position? Well, what it does without any RF aiding is it takes the raw inertial positions from the four inertial reference units and creates what's known as a triple mix solution with IRUs 1, 2, and 3. The fourth IRU is essentially in that mode used as a backup sensor. Now we can bring in RF updating from a variety of sources, either on the Block 16 or Block 17. And if those sources are anything except GPS, the mission computer will once per second perform a position update and then 5 times per second display a projection of the parallel path, if you will, on the glass in the cockpit. Now, when GPS is selected as a position update source in the mission computer, the mission computer essentially uses IRU1's blended inertial solution directly, either from IRU number 1 or IRU number 4, depending on the pilot ID switch, which essentially determines in the cockpit which crew position is flying and navigating the airplane. In the bottom right, you'll see a sample page from the mission computer. That's our nav sensors IRS page. And typically, that's either going to show three IRUs in large font, which will determine, which will give feedback to the aviators that that the triple mix solution is being used, or one IRU in large font, either one or four when GPS is brought into the solution. We have some feedback now on what exactly is being brought into the solution on the nav sensors control page. We have a variety of inputs, or enunciations, you might say, anywhere from IRU when the triple mix solution is being utilized, to civil GPS and or military GPS, eGPS or mGPS, for the Block 17. Now, the civil GPS is basically employing what is known as a containment solution. That civil GPS receiver is containing the present position solution from the IRUs and is then allowing, in essence, the aircraft present position to be certified for civil airspace use. There's some other non-GPS, non-IRU related modes, which we'll just kind of skip in the interest of time. But I also thought it would be interesting for the group to see some of the information that we see on the GPS system in the actual cockpit itself. Obviously, the key status is self-explanatory. We can load the keys for daily, weekly, monthly, or even longer with the OTAR. And I thought it would also be interesting to basically bring in the -1-2 mission computer benefits of keying the GPS. So basically, our flight manual is telling us navigation accuracy slightly improved. We're getting errors induced by the ionosphere reduced, and we are being protected from intentional or unintentional interference. And beyond that, jamming with the SERPA antenna. We can also see, if you kind of look in the bottom right corner, it's a bit challenging, but you can see a number of satellites in view for each GPS receiver, its present position, and then an estimate of horizontal error and vertical error. So we need to talk a little bit about performance-based navigation, and while you read what the more formal definition is on performance-based navigation, for the aviator, performance-based navigation is essentially the suite of sensors on the airplane that allow the aircrew to execute point-to-point navigation without using ground-based RF navigates. And so there are two very common instantiations of performance-based navigation, the first being RNAV, or area navigation, and the second being RNP, or required navigation performance. RNAV and RNP, we're going to get into a little bit more here, but the big difference between RNAV and RNP is RNAV is going to provide the aircrew with enunciations on when it feels the navigation performance is insufficient for the specific airspace that the airplane understands that it's in. It's going to be able to alert the aircrew with a master caution, but it's not going to do what RNP, or required navigation performance, brings in, which is basically performance monitoring and additional alerting. Okay, so for RNAV, the RNAV implementation on the C-17, we utilize table-based mission computer figure of merit, which is, as I understand, the derivative from the GPS receiver figure of merit that's provided all the way down in the circuit card assembly itself. Now, for required navigation performance, there's a much better understanding by the aircrew on what the actual navigation performance of the airplane is, because the airplane tells you. The airplane will tell you, I believe my actual navigation performance is this quantity, you know, this specific quantity. Okay? And similar to RNAV, if the actual navigation performance becomes greater than the requirement for the specific airspace, again, the airplane is going to provide an alert to the aircrew in the form of an unable RNP enunciation, as well as a master caution in the airplane to alert the crew that they need to do something. So now that you have a basic understanding of RNAV, RNP, and navigation, airspace navigation, it's interesting to note what the current state-of-the-art C-17 Block 16 and Block 17 are capable of or are certified for. So the Block 16 brings us certifications essentially all the way down to RNAV-1, which allows us to fly standard terminal arrivals and RNAV-based standard instrument departures. What's notably missing in the Block 16 but comes into the Block 17, and it is a function of the new two GPS receivers in the pleasers I just mentioned, is the capability of RNP 0.3, which is GPS non-precision approach, again, down to RNP 0.3. I have a little bit of information just for the audience general understanding of what kind of air crew certifications are required with the new airspace. It's basically a multitude of simulator training and computer-based training. So now that we know that the Block 16 and the Block 17 are certified for a variety or a plethora of different types of RNAV, RNP airspace, we need to understand as an aircrew how to operate the airplane in a legal fashion. So for the Block 16, if you see this table excerpt I pulled from the flight manual, for example, in the top left corner, hopefully you can read that in the back, but that's MNPS, or basically Min Nav Performance Standard. That's essentially the standard that allows us oceanic crossings. And for the Block 16, as I mentioned, without a full RNP certification and only the RNAV cert, we as an aircrew need to ensure that A, we are updating the aircraft navigation present position accordingly with this table to ensure that we are authorized, and B, we need to ensure that the required mission computer figure of merit is met for the entire phase of flight. So in this case, for MNPS, or for a North Atlantic Oceanic Crossing, I need to ensure that the GPS updating, DME updating, or frankly a triple mix, no update source is being selected. So any is okay. I just need to make sure that my mission computer figure of merit remains below 8. What the hell does that mean? I really don't know. You have to go into the flight manual and you have to look into it, and I'll show you that in a minute, okay? And that's one of the challenges with all the different types of airspace and understanding from an aircrew perspective what the airplane performance is in the current state of affairs, if you will. Let's talk about the Block 17. Things get a lot better now. Now, instead of mission computer figure of merit, in the second column, you can see a required ANP, or actual navigation performance. So to be in that same airspace, MNPS, or to perform an oceanic crossing, I know that my performance needs to remain within 12.6 nautical miles of actual navigation performance to be in that, again, to be in that airspace. I can do that using civil GPS, military GPS, DME, or coasting off the IRU's triple mix. All of those are authorized. But I will cage your eyes to the bottom note, which says, when in civil airspace, do not use a GPS loaded with PPS as an update source. Okay? That's really interesting.
Why is that?
We'll come back to that at the end. And frankly, I might even pose the same question back to this audience. But I also would like to say, for GPS approach RNP 0.3, we now have a new line at the bottom of this table. We are now authorized, and again, look in that, let's see, 1, 2, 3, fourth column, MGPS, not authorized. Okay, so my regulatory guidance tells me I am not authorized to use my best capabilities to fly in my most constraining airspace. Why is that? That's a great question. I don't know the answer to that either. The GPS host application equipment certifications are there. And what we're calling our IRUs are Honeywell 764 EGIs, specifically tailored for our airframe. And I understand that the 764 box has both TSO C-145A and MSO C-145A and the appropriate aircraft circular certifications. So is it a matter of the program office and the operational side of the house getting in sync? I really don't know. There may be some other airworthiness discussions that have to happen, but from a certification and performance perspective, the box should allow us, and we should be legal to fly with our best capabilities. So how accurate is the system? Well, we really have to look into the Block 16 primarily to answer that question. and it's going to become obvious in a moment. But as I mentioned, the mission computer is creating, developing, and providing a figure of merit for both for all of the inertial reference units, as well as its own developed present position calculation. And those figures of merit translate into estimates of horizontal error. And the only way to obtain that information is to dig into page 1,000 plus in the flight manual and look this up. And I can tell you, I didn't know that was there until I went looking for it. And I'm pretty confident 99% of my air crew brothers, sisters, friends are unaware, if you will, of that quantitative assessment of figure of merit. We also get some performance information if we're just in IRU Coast. In other words, we're not updating with RF nav aids. So the IMS present position triple mix solution is pretty decent without the updates, relatively speaking. We'll get at most a nautical mile per hour of drift, which in RMP 12.6 airspace means I could turn the GPS off and fly across the ocean and be legal. I could do that. Okay, Lot 16 only. Why don't I have any performance information for Block 17? I just told you, Block 17 tells me every second how good the navigation solution is. It will tell me anytime I want to look. It's in the glass. It's on the displays. It's the actual navigation performance. And through my experience flying the jet, it's typically 0.03 nautical miles or less. It's phenomenal. At least that's what it's telling. Receiver autonomous integrity monitoring. I don't want to go into this too much just to save a little bit of time, but what is valuable for everybody to understand is that GPS receiver card capability is brought through the host application equipment, in this case the IRU or EGI, and is a function built into the mission computer. The predictive rain check is required by our regulatory guidance for any planned mission driven time on target for air refueling, airdrop, and obviously GPS departure, arrival, and approach. And that's done by setting a fixed or advisory time constraint in the flight plan once I program it in when I get to the jet with the paperwork. Anytime I get information, annunciations, or frankly the jet complaining that it's not happy with the GPS, we are prohibited from flying RNAV GPS. Departures, arrivals, or approaches. But I will tell you, in my experience, in the last five-ish years, or the time in which this has been valid, I've never had that problem. So take that for what it's worth. Okay, degraded operation. How good is the system? Well, it's pretty damn good, actually. I've only ever experienced one GPS-related error or mission delay, although about 2 weeks ago, I was on a night air refueling sortie, and the damn KC-135 tanker showed up late because they had an EGI GPS problem. So they're out there, and it pissed me off because it made my night longer. But in the C-17, our box is good. All right. So what the information that we get, typically CGPS or MGPS 1 or 2, it's going to tell us which GPS and in which type of receiver we have a problem. If both receivers fail on a specific instantiation, i.e. IRU or pleaser, we'll just simply get a CGPS or MGPS on our warning enunciation panel in the jet. What can I do about it? Really not much, and frankly, I put almost verbatim the crew response remarks from our -1 flight manual, and that's basically saying, find something else to use, and it's really not that big of a deal right now for depending on the duration that you need the capability, with the advent of required navigation performance. Because I can turn GPS updating off, right? And if my actual navigation performance is, let's say, 0.03, and I start drifting at 1 nautical mile per hour, I'm going to be good for a while, unless I immediately need to execute a GPS approach. Okay, second part, how do we use this, all right? And you're going to have to excuse some of the air crew jargon. I tried to take it out as much as possible. But what you're seeing is basically a a reduction or a distillation, if you will, of some training that I provide on GPS operation, RNAV GPS procedures, rather, to my squadron. And frankly, we call this a CRM, or crew resource management nightmare. It's a pain in the ass. I mean, when you consider the other approach procedures, or if you compare this to a traditional instrument landing system type approach, there's a lot of extra work that you've got to do to fly a GPS approach. And frankly, there's good reasons for that. So let's talk about it. So if I'm planning any RNAV GPS type of departure, arrival, or approach at pre-flight, there's some special things that I need to do. So I need to obviously check the notices to airmen, but in particular, I need to check the GPS notams. I need to make sure that if there are any planned outages, right, as many of you in this this room might know, and I'm looking way to the back, that if the GPS satellites or structure or some segment thereof won't be available, we need to know about that. We need to manually disable that in the receiver itself. Once we do that, once we get comfortable and we're good to go, we need to get to the jet, fire up the avionics, and make sure that we have a good initial present position. We align, typically, we align the inertial reference units via a GPS alignment. So it takes the GPS present position from the receiver, circuit card assembly built inside, and then it uses that present position to align all four of the inertial reference units. We'll perform a predictive range check as required. Again, I talked about that briefly. We are prohibited from flying terminal procedures if the predictive range check isn't completed. We need to review the RNAV procedure. So that's actually a pain in the ass, because you need to look at every specific RNAV waypoint and ensure that segment distances and headings are within specified tolerances. I think I included a little bit more information up there. One thing that is nice is we have a worldwide nav database, which typically the pointy nose guys won't have. So they're limited to the GPS or RNAV data points that they load into their mission planning system beforehand, before they commence the mission. We've got a nav database, so we can go anywhere, we can change our plans anytime, but we need to make sure that database is updated, otherwise all bets are off and we don't fly. For all RNAV operations, we need to make sure that our flight director is engaged. For those of you who aren't super familiar with the aviation world, if you take a look at this primary flight display on the right-hand side, it is the magenta crosshairs that essentially are providing steering commands to either the pilot who's flying or the autopilot and auto throttles if they're coupled up. And we need to make sure that that flight director is on and set correctly, so that the steering commands to the flyer or to the autopilot are coming from the appropriate source, namely the mission computer in this case, right? Not from a stored heading, not from a present heading, or not from another radio-based navigation aid. We set the bank angle and the roll rate to normal to remain within the specific protected airspace. So if we are in a tactical mode on bank and roll, or a non-tactical mode, for example, on coming off of an air evac mission, then we are not guaranteed to remain within the protected airspace for the GPS procedures. Because we're only authorized to fly non-precision approaches, we only can use vertical speed guidance, not vertical steering commands from the final approach fix to the missed approach point. What that essentially means is we don't follow precise vertical guidance down to a decision height, typically around, we would say, 200 feet off the ground. We need to make sure that the cross-track error is half of the required navigation performance for the flight. So I don't know how well you can see. We're kind of tweaking it beforehand, but in the very bottom, you're going to see a diamond and some dots. In the center diamond, okay, we need to make sure that we don't allow our lateral track for the airplane to exceed one dot, okay? That means we'll go beyond the protected airspace for that particular phase of flight, if you will. We are reminded, warned, etc., to always be prepared to intervene if something goes haywire, goes wrong, or we lose GPS lock, if you will, and bring the wheels over. So how do we fly departure and arrival, RNP of 1? We, prior to executing the procedure, this is just a quick synopsis of things in an RNAV GPS checklist that we run prior to every procedure. We'll double check that the GPS obviously is operating and updating. We make sure that there's no mission computer radio-based nav aid source from any other source. We have to make sure that there's no flight plan discontinuity after the runway for a specific type of radar vector departures. If we delete that, the airplane will actually turn itself in the wrong direction if we're not watching. So that's a very, very important step. The pilot flying will use the heads-up display or the primary flight display with the flight director. For Block 16, as we already talked about, we have to make sure that the update status is GPS, and we have to verify the mission computer figure of merit again, which is below 4, this magic number. For Block 17, we just simply make sure that the GPS updating source is the civil GPS. We also verify the present position of the airplane on the navigation map display. We need to make sure that the airplane symbol is within 1,000 feet of the runway departure end, and we have some techniques to do that. We will arm our mission lateral navigation flight mission annunciation, basically our coupling to the flight, to the autopilot rather, unless there's radar vectors and we have to immediately make a turn off of departure. But we have to ensure that mission lateral navigation is active no later than 500 feet after liftoff. Again, verify bank and roll rates are set to norm. Departure and approach procedures. You can't read all the words, which is a little disappointing. I wanted to give you a little highlight of what kind of notes are on these approach plates and charts and gotchas. These are departure, a standard terminal arrival and a standard instrument departure RNAV GPS based from LAX. Many of us were probably sitting on the back of an airplane and didn't know we were on this ground track coming out here. But the point here is, for every single star or waypoint you see on there, the air crew is now obligated to verify waypoint distances down to 0.1 nautical miles, right? Because we're pulling all these nav aid positions from a database, and we need to make sure the headings between each of those two points are within 5 degrees. That's a lot of work every single time. And what happens if you get rerouted on the procedure? You know, and by the way, that's a perfectly good jet. What happens if you got some other degraded mode on the airplane or some other issue is going on? Or, heaven forbid, you're in a combat zone and there are other higher pressing requirements. So just food for thought. There's a lot of work, additional work, that goes into verifying that you can fly these procedures. In the NRAID structure, for RNP greater than 2, we need to make sure that the airplane sequences to RNP, or required navigation performance mode, once we are on non-RF based, land-based nav aid jet routes. So typically in this case, if we were flying and we were told to intercept this Q110 airway at waypoint Thunder, we would be obligated to verify that the jet transitions to RNP ops and went to RNP 2. Okay, approach RNP of 0.3 can be done on the Block 17 aircraft, as we talked about. We need to verify weather requirements are within limits, 1,000 feet on the ceiling, 2 statute miles of visibility. For us, by regulatory guidance, we're only authorized to fly RNAV GPS approaches, or approaches, frankly, that have GPS in the title. We only go down to LNAV, lateral navigation, min descent altitude, basically non-precision approach, even though there are GPS precision-based approaches, as many of you know. Our normal aircraft configuration setup will be an autopilot, all throttles are engaged. We'll have the navigation map with the course deviation indicator, basically those little diamonds, that same screen, if you will, on one multifunction display. And we'll have that lateral deviation indicator, course deviation indicator, showing at least both pilot and co-pilot side. Okay, similar to the departure, there's a discontinuity in the flight plan. We can't delete if we want to execute the missed approach procedure. We need to arm the mission lateral navigation routing when we are clear for the approach, and we need to verify that the actual navigation performance goes below 0.3, and if not, we need to abort the procedure. Missed approach brings in its own constraints. Suffice to say, no need to belabor the point, but in summary here, if we don't execute the missed approach procedure at the quote-unquote appropriate leg of the GPS approach, we will have to take manual, or we'll have to implement manual intervention. And that means that while we are low, slow, and trying to climb away from the ground, one of the crew members has to go head down and take some action, which isn't ideal. And I think, let's see here, one more chart. Okay, quick summary, right? We talked about the navigation capabilities of the C-17. You've got hopefully an understanding of this concept of triple mix, as well as GPS, the GPS present position into the NAV solution. Hopefully you have a little understanding now of RNAV, RNP, and performance-based navigation, some of the constraints, operational as well as degraded modes. And then we talked very briefly about operating the jet for RNAV RNP ops. While I had some of you in this room, and many more later, frankly, you know, I just wanted to throw out there, you know, as Michael said earlier, he's got family members that are using this, you know, brothers, sisters, countrymen that use these capabilities to get us to safe places and keep us safe. And I want, you know, all of the people in this room to consider, you know, efficiencies and implementation for these things. Because one of the two big takeaways I want to make sure that everybody understands is, you know, from a C-17 perspective, we are precluded from using our best capabilities 99% of the time because of the civil certification issue. There is plenty of additional information that the air crew could use if they're brought into the discussion on how these things are integrated all the way from, you know, from the circuit card assembly to the host application equipment and obviously all the way into the platform. Okay, so just some thoughts as we go forward, because I know we have a lot of developers in here. And Dream, I want to turn it back over to you for the last 15 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
And then if we have time, we can go to videos, but
yeah, videos. So, all right, thanks. We got about 10 minutes or so left. So this is kind of a one-upsmanship thing, but it's happening the other way. Yeah, we'll talk about the navigation equipment on the on a Hornet, which is almost nothing. You know, camera's got four INSs. We got the same INS in 764 variant called the ANAV, but we got one of them. The older Hornets. Yeah, we're still using the F-18A all the way through the F-18G, the Growler. So the early ones still have maggers, the five-channel maggers. Some of the intermediate Hornet variants have the Magger 2K. The more recent ones have the H-764 ANAV, and then there's most of the super Hornets have that. However, you know, with a single INS or integrated INS GPS system, we only have a few modes. We don't have all of the civil aviation integration that the C-17 does, but we do have full integration with all the systems on the aircraft. Our primary mode of navigation is assisted INS, so that's the GPS picking the INS information and providing a combined solution for use on the platform. If there are issues with that, then we revert to an INS mode. We can update that INS through various options. And if the INS and the GPS are both not working because the box has gone bad, Then we have a combination of the radar and the air data computer providing us positional information, and that's when we get back to that discussion on DR. We think we were here, we're going to here, to here, to here. We can get some updates throughout that time period. Okay? For our symbology, we'll talk through a few of the different symbology features that we have. This is the F-18 HUD heads-up display. For navigation, we'll have the indicator of true heading. If necessary, the other heading is magnetic heading. The velocity vector, this is a combined output of the GPS and INS showing the actual position where the aircraft will be going. So that's our impact point, and we can use that through a variety of means for navigation. If all of our systems are down, there isn't a precision approach available, and we're operating in weather, we don't have to go anywhere else, there's something we can use called a self-contained approach or a Hornet approach, where we use a radar, we designate the end of the runway, and then we fly our velocity vector straight to the target designation, and that'll break us out of the end of the runway, even though there's no approach and there's no visibility. Obviously not the preferred method. There's a whole lot of other issues associated with doing something like that. But it's a means that we do have available to us in the case where, like Cameron said, we're operating where there isn't an opportunity to get direction from vectors from the controller or anything like that. Okay. So that's our basic HUD display. When we're in the landing mode, this brings into our some of our final approach procedure stuff. Similar to Cameron's diamonds on the bottom, this display is related to the course line that we put into the waypoint or the nav aid that's been loaded, and it shows us how far off that sequence line or that course line we are. We don't have any civil navigation approach equipment in the jet. We have two precision approach systems, but they're primarily for the carrier. This is called the ICLS, the Instrument Carrier Landing System. And then what we don't see on here, this one's called the Bullseye. And then we have one that looks like a bullseye that we call the Needles. And that's the automated carrier landing system. And that's one where we can fully couple the aircraft to the radar on the ship, and it'll bring us down to a full stop landing on the carrier. Okay, so those are our two precision approach capabilities in the Hornet, but those are military only, carrier specifically only systems. Right. We talked about the ability to couple. We do have some pilot relief modes, but not a whole lot of them. We can't couple up to an approach or anything like that. We can couple to a sequence line, so we can put a couple waypoints in, couple to that sequence line, but we wouldn't use that for an approach. The bank angle and roll rate is adjustable. It's either really fast or pretty fast, and neither one of them is real comfortable to be just letting the aircraft do it on its own if it's going around the corner on that sequence line. Okay, and then this is a display, something like what we would see if we were doing that self-contained approach. That's what would be in the HUD at the designation at the end of the runway. We get that off the radar screen, and then we just fly our velocity vector to that based on the degree glide slope. So he's about 2.5 degrees nose down right now, but he's not pointed at the target. All right. Okay, moving on. Different nav modes. We talked about some of the backup navigation mode systems. But we don't have a whole lot of display management. Cameron talked about his DG, waypoint database. This is what we have. We can load this through our joint mission planning system into the aircraft. But in order to use any of these waypoints, we have to actually transfer them into the waypoint database. So we got to transfer them from the data card into the system and assign them a waypoint number. Okay, so we do all our work through waypoint numbers. We don't dial in or type in Leroy if we want to go to fix Leroy. We load Leroy into the system and then add waypoint 4 as Leroy for navigation. And then we would highlight that waypoint for steering information. Okay. a platform is. This is our horizontal situation indicator, or multi-purpose color display. It normally would have a full color background map in it, but I just kept this one so that it's easier to see. This is a tack end there. There's a steering line through the tack end. This is a designated target there, and I'm hitting steering to actually to nothing right now, because there's nothing selected on that. Okay, but this is what our display works, and this is something we normally keep it in our center display, which is kind of between our legs in front of the stick. Most of the work we do is on the side displays, which are easier to see in the HUD. We saw the triple solution display in the C-17. This is all the type of information that we get from the HUD. Again, we only have one INS, GPS, and one air data computer, so we only get a little bit of information if we need it. The biggest figure of merit type information we get is the horizontal and vertical error, and the vertical error, the HERS and MERS, and those are the only assessment of what information we have. All right. So skip the videos. We talked about the relief modes, and here's some degraded indications that we can have. Again, not a whole lot with relation to the navigation system. Vertical velocity or horizontal velocities are outside of limits. The GPS is degraded, so we wouldn't use that as part of our approach solution. We deselect that as for being a solution, part of the position solution. Mission Computer 1, if that fails, that loses our GPS. So we're, if that happens, that's kind of a bad day. That fail means the whole system's gone. Now we're operating with our eyes and with our ears and flying what the controllers have us do. All right. So that's about it. Again, the Hornet is obviously not designed to be a civil navigation type airplane. We have some abilities that model, and certainly have the precision required, like Cameron said, but we're not certified, we're not allowed to do these types of approaches with the system that we have. A lot of it has to do with crew management. As a single-seat pilot, it's tough to punch into a whole bunch of stuff, certainly when we're on an approach. I rely on my ears if we're doing stuff like that and looking at the Cameron at least has another person to help him out and do some of the administrative work to get the information out so the plane can go where it needs to go. But that's about it. What can we expect? That's what we're here for. This whole week is going to be about looking to the future, looking at what's currently going on in development and in the process of navigation and some of the technology that's out there. So I won't get into any of these. But looking forward to a fantastic conference. All who want are not lost. So, are there any questions or any comments? Kim? Anything? All right, well, thanks everybody. Mike, over to you.
Well, a couple of videos if you want.
Sure.
We've got about 3 minutes.
Okay.
So, and they can pick one of your favorites. There we go. And everyone knows to go to 103 is where the plenary is.
So this is one video just showing some of the capabilities of things that we do, flying around the boat. This is an F-18 Growler. So this is from the initial phases of OIS. We put this together. So the video quality is pre-HD. So it's not the greatest, but there's some good video about what's going on. I'll talk through some of the things that we've seen.
The damage did occur in full HD, though, right?
Yes, the damage did occur in full lights, full HD.